Bună ziua și bine v-am regăsit la o nouă lecție de chimie. Dacă ora trecută am vorbit despre metodele de separare ale unui amestec heterogen, adică despre decantare și filtrare, astăzi vom învăța despre cum putem separa componentele unui amestec omogen. Pentru aceasta o să vă rog ca într-o capsulă de porțelan să puneți apă și sare de bucătărie. Ce observați? Puteți folosi una din metodele de separare anterioare pentru separarea acestui amestec? De ce? Încălziți capsula în flacăra unui bec de gaz sau a unei spirtiere până la evaporarea completă a apei. Ce observați? Veți observa că sarea se dizolvă în apă și se obține un amestec omogen. Prin fierberea soluției, apa se evaporă, iar în capsulă rămâne sarea curată. Cristalizarea este deci operația de separare a componentelor unui amestec omogen solid-lichid. Prin încălzire, substanța lichidă se evaporă, iar solidul cristalizează. Cristalul este un corp solid, omogen, cu formă geometrică bine determinată. La ce se folosește cristalizarea? Zahărul se obține prin cristalizare din sucul extras din sfecla de zahăr. Sarea de bucătărie se poate obține la fel prin procesul de cristalizare din apa mării. În continuare, o să vă rog să montați instalația de distilare ca în figura de mai jos. Pentru aceasta aveți nevoie de un balon viurț, refrigerent, vas de colectare, sursă de încălzire, termometru și o sită metalică din asbest. Introduceți un amestec de apă și alcool în balonul viurț. Încălziți amestecul la fierbere și urmăriți temperatura indicată de termometru. Alcoolul fierbe la 78 grade Celsius, temperatura rămânând constantă până la vaporizarea totală a alcoolului. Când temperatura începe să crească, schimbați paharul și îndepărtați sursa de încălzire. Ce observați? Veți observa că alcoolul și apa formează un amestec omogen. Alcoolul este o substanță organică cu miros specific, cu temperatura de fierbere 78 grade Celsius. Apa este o substanță anorganică cu temperatura de fierbere 100 grade Celsius. Vaporii de alcool, incolori, condensează pe pereții reci ai refrigerentului. În vasul de colectare se adună alcoolul distilat, care se recunoaște după miros. Distilarea este așadar operația de separare a unei substanțe dintr-un amestec omogen lichid-lichid prin vaporizare urmată de condensarea vaporilor. Această operație se bazează pe diferența dintre temperaturile de fierbere ale substanțelor componente. Substanța lichidă colectată se numește distilat, iar impuritățile rămase în balonul de distilare alcătuiesc rezidul. La ce se folosește distilarea? Pentru obținerea băuturilor alcoolice și pentru separarea componentelor din petrol.
Educația copiilor noștri trebuie să meargă mai departe, însă au nevoie de noi pentru a avea grijă atât de ei cât și de ceilalți. Păstrăm distanța chiar și la joacă. Purtăm masca mereu ca niște supereroi. Respectăm indicațiile profesorilor. Rămânem acasă, dacă așa ne spune doctorul. O echipă puternică se formează de acasă, iar noi suntem alături de cei mici către un viitor mai bun. Campanie de informare susținută de Guvernul României.
Hello everyone! Welcome! This will be your English class. We are Nicoleta Velescu
and Daniela Năpârdică
and we're going to learn English together. Let's see. Today we're going to talk about
describing people,
which means physical appearance,
personality adjectives,
and hobbies and free time activities. Here we go. When we describe a person, we talk about appearance by asking the question, what does he look like? For instance, this boy, he is handsome, tall, and blonde-haired. Then we talk about character with the question, what is he like? This boy is smart, friendly, and outgoing. Last but not least, about a person's hobbies. What does he like? He likes playing the guitar and gaming. Let's take each one individually. Physical appearance. People are different all over the world. When we want to know about someone's physical appearance, don't forget, the question is, what does he, she look like? When we describe a person physically, we usually mention the following aspects: age, height, build, hair, eyes, and other features. Let's take them separately. Age. A person can be young, she's 23 years old. Middle-aged, he's 46 years old. And old or elderly person, he is 89 years old. If we are to get into details, there are a lot of things we can say. For instance, from the moment you're born to the age of one, you're a baby. Then, up to the age of two, you're a toddler. Up to the age of 12, you're a child. Between the ages of 13 and 17, just like you, you are a teenager or a young person, or you are in your teens. When you turn 18, you become an adult or a grown-up. From the age of 20 up to 29, a person is in his or her 20s. Or when we don't know the exact age, we can say he or she is 20-something. To be more specific, from 20 to 23, you are in your early 20s, from 24 to 26 in your mid-20s, 27 to 29 in your late 20s. This goes on and on with numbers 40s, 50s, something like that. When you get to the age of 45, you're considered to be middle-aged. When you turn 75, you are an elderly person or a senior citizen. Let's continue. This person, she is young, she is 32 years old, she is in her early 30s.
He is middle-aged, he is 46 years old, he is in his mid-40s.
Let's move on to height. People can be short, medium or average height, or tall. The question we ask, how tall is he? How tall is she? Then we answer, he or she is 1.78 meters tall or 1 meter 78 centimeters tall. Moving on to build or weight, how a person looks. People can be skinny, like this girl here, slim, like the boy, well, fat, like this man, overweight, plump or chubby, or muscular. But what you should remember is that no matter what you weigh, you are beautiful. Let's take a look at this young lady. She is medium or average height and slim.
He is tall and muscular.
Going on to hair. We talk about hair length, hairstyle, and hair color. Hair length, people can have short hair, shoulder length hair, long hair, or they can have no hair, they can be bald. In terms of hairstyle, people's hair can be straight, curly, wavy, or spiky. We have one more thing about the hairstyle, but it's especially for you girls. When you have your hair tied up, it can be in a ponytail at the back, in two pigtails, in plaits or braids, in buns. You can have a fringe, or you can have dreadlocks. hair color, people can be blonde, they can be brown, they can have brown hair, they can have black hair, red hair, or ginger hair. Some people, when they get older, have gray hair and even white hair. Remember, to talk about hair, the sequence is length, style, and color. Let's see some examples. What does she look like? She has long, straight, blonde hair.
What does he look like? He has short, curly, brown hair.
Eyes. The eyes can be brown, blue, and green. There are also other colors, but they're not as common as the three here. Other features. People are special, and some have freckles. Others have a beard and a mustache. Others have dimples. They can also wear glasses. Let's revise what we have learned. To talk about physical experience, the order is we have to describe age, height and build, hair and eyes, and then the other features. Remember, this girl here, what does she look like? She is young, she is in her 30s, she is tall and slim with long, straight brown hair and green eyes. She has a dimple.
What does he look like? He is middle-aged, he is in his 40s, he is tall and muscular, he has short, spiky gray hair and brown eyes. He's got a beard and glasses.
Now, it's your turn. Let's see.
What does she look like? She is 16 years old. She is in her teens. She is tall and slim. She has ginger hair. And I think blue eyes. She's got freckles on her face.
And she's really pretty. This nice young lady, she is 83 years old. She is in her early 80s, in her 80s. She is short and thin. She has curly white hair and I think probably blue or green eyes. Then she's got glasses. Let's move on to some boys. Again.
What does he look like? He is 26 years old and I guess he's in his late 20s. He is tall and well-built, muscular. He has black hair and brown eyes and he's got dimples.
Okay, this one here, he is 33 years old. He is in his early 30s. He's tall and I guess well-built. He has spiky ginger hair and blue eyes. He's got a beard and a mustache. Okay, well done. Let's move on to personality adjectives. Well, when we want to know about a person's character, the question is, what is he, she like? Let's see. Personality adjectives, they can be qualities, which means good aspects of a person, or flaws or defects, which means bad aspects of a person. Now, let's take a closer look at your friends. Your friends have definitely a lot of qualities, but they also have some flaws, like everybody else. They can be funny, silly, clever, intelligent, kind, punctual, or stubborn. What are your friends like? We're going to take a look at some adjectives describing personality. Are they nice to people? Are they friendly?
A friendly person is kind and pleasant to be around.
Or a do they treat other people badly? Are they unfriendly or rude?
An unfriendly person is not nice to others.
Do they like meeting other people? Are they sociable or outgoing?
A sociable person makes friends easily and enjoys people's company.
Or maybe they're rather nervous around other people. Are they shy?
A shy person avoids crowded places and doesn't talk too much. Do they talk all the time? Are they talkative, chatty?
Well, a talkative person enjoys conversation and sometimes never stops talking.
Do they talk only if it is necessary? Are they quiet, reserved?
A quiet person doesn't like talking too much and prefers silence. Do they often give presents or share what they have with others? Are they generous?
A generous person likes to give others what he or she has just to make them happy.
Or do they keep what they have only to themselves? Are they selfish or mean?
A selfish person doesn't like sharing his things with others. Do they always tell you the truth? Are they honest?
An honest person never tells lies and can be trusted.
Do they tend to tell you lies? Are they dishonest?
Well, a dishonest person is insincere and tries to trick people.
Are they in a good mood? Are they cheerful or happy?
A cheerful person is always full of joy and smiles a lot.
Are they happy one moment and then sad the next? Are they moody?
A moody person changes his attitude quickly and sometimes just like that for no reason. Do your friends work hard and achieve their goals? Are they hardworking or ambitious?
A hardworking person works very hard and likes to succeed.
Or maybe do they prefer to waste time and do nothing? Are they lazy, unmotivated?
A lazy person doesn't enjoy working too much. Do they engage in dangerous activities willingly? Are they courageous? Are they brave?
Person is not afraid of danger and enjoys adventure.
Are they afraid of doing anything? Are they cowardly?
A cowardly person lacks courage. Do they always see the bright side of things in any situation? Are they optimistic?
An optimistic person is positive that things will be all fine and hopeful about the future.
Or maybe do they constantly believe that bad things are about to happen? Are they pessimistic?
A pessimistic person focuses on the negative side of life.
Now, let's remember what we have discussed. My friend always tells the truth. What is he like?
God.
Come on, I'm sure you know it.
I think he's honest.
Yes, you're right.
My friend makes everybody laugh.
Well, he's funny.
Good. My friend doesn't talk much.
I'm afraid he's rather shy. Or quiet, look. My friend is kind to everyone.
He's kind? Friendly?
Yes, that's right.
My friends love going to parties.
They are definitely outgoing or sociable. My friend is happy all the time.
He's cheerful. My friend never stops chatting.
Well, that makes him or her talkative. And the last one, my friend enjoys extreme sports.
I think he's brave, courageous.
Yes, you're right. Okay, how would you describe your friend? Now, we are going to watch a short video. You are going to watch a short video about people describing their friends.
Hello, welcome to Live from London, brought to you by One Stop English. Today we're in Brixton and we're going to be asking people about their friends. Could you describe your best friend or a very good friend?
She's fun, she's a Kiwi like me. We both moved over here actually, and we're both living over here together, and she's fun and bubbly. And yeah. I like to think she's a bit like me because we get on so well.
How would you describe him?
Loyal. Good friend, got my back.
Yeah.
He's just a friend for life. From school he's been my mate, you know what
cool.
I mean?
So. Cool.
She's got a really good heart. She's somebody who I trust. You know, I can always go for advice. She'll always make me laugh. She's got a really bubbly personality, and she doesn't really have a bad bone in her body. So I think that's the reason why she's a really good friend to me, and one that I'll always trust and hopefully have for life.
Okay. Emily, she's an artist. And she doesn't speak to me for like a year, and then she's like, sorry, but I know we're always going to be good friends, so I know that I can just be myself, and I know that you're always there, and I'm the same with her.
My best friend is somebody I can, I trust in him, he trusts in me, we can get good time, in bad moments we can count on each other.
I think it was a Spice Girls concert actually that I actually met her. Yeah, and I suppose it was just really her personality that really, yeah, that really made me take to her more than sort of anything else, because I didn't, before I was introduced to her, I didn't know anything about her. So just really her personality. And then, you know, when you find that you have things in common, the same likes, so it's just kind of easy to then develop a friendship from there, because obviously you share that shared interest. So
you met at school?
We met from school, yeah.
How old were you?
That was 1971.
Okay.
And it's now 2015.
So it's been a long...
That was my first year at secondary school.
So first year at secondary school.
I let you do the maths.
What shared interests do you have?
I think we like to travel. That's why we both come over here.
Yeah.
And we like to read and just relax and a bit of shopping as well.
What shared interests do you have with her?
Oh my God, well, I was a teenager at the time, so obviously I think it was just really going out. Nothing really about morals or, you know, changing the world and people. It was just really, just really a good socialising.
Are those the shared interests you have now, then, changing the world together?
No, not really, unfortunately. But yes, I suppose our friendship has sort of like developed into, obviously, as we've grown into adulthood, into, you know, more serious, really, aspects of life, really.
Yeah. What shared interests do you have with her?
We used to do witchcraft together.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so we used to do spells, and we used to sleep with our hair tied together. So we thought that we'd, like, go into each other's minds in the night.
Well, this was a nice video. Now, let's see some vocabulary. What was that? Some words might seem difficult to you, so let's take a look at them. Along the video, we have heard some expressions like he or she has my back. What do you think this means? It's a person who you can always rely on. So someone you can rely on. He or she has a good heart. This means that this person is caring, kind, friendly. Someone said that her friend doesn't have a bad bone in her body. What could that mean? It means that this person has no bad qualities. When you are yourself, you are able to be comfortable being you. This usually happens around friends or family. When people count on each other, they can rely on each other as friends. So whenever they need a friend, they can go to that person. One girl said that her friend has a bubbly personality. Bubbly, this is like water bubbles, which move up and down. This means that she's lively and cheerful all the time. A friend for life is what everybody wants to have, and it's someone who will be your friend forever. Let's see. Friend, or maybe not. We're going to look at some sentences together, and you will decide whether the sentence is suitable for a friend, the description, or not. So, thumbs up or thumbs down. Let's see.
Talks about me behind my back.
Yes, that's a bad thing to do, even to those who are not your friends. Listens to me when I'm talking. Well, yes, that's a friend.
Helps me when I need it.
That's what a friend should do, so thumbs up again. Says nice things about me all the time. Again, a good friend.
Cheats whenever we play games. Well, that's a really bad thing, I think. He's not a friend.
Yeah, I'm sure he's not a friend. Shares things with me. That's good. So, thumbs up.
Makes fun of the way I look. Well, no, he's not a friend.
That's a bad thing to do again. Stands up for me. This means he's there when I need her or him. That's a friend.
Never wants to hang out with me. Well, if he doesn't want to spend time with me, he's not my friend.
That's sure. Yells at me when I make mistakes. That's bad again, because people do make mistakes.
Is kind and respectful to me.
Well done, yay, friend. Helps me feel better when I'm sad or mad. Again, what a friend should really do. So, if you take a look at the thumbs up, they're more than the thumbs down, which means you are friends to your friends, or maybe they're friends to you. But what you should know is that no matter what your friends are like, you have to remember that they are the people that make you smile brighter, laugh louder, and live better. Do you know this TV series? They're always friendly to each other. Now, we move on to free time activities and hobbies. When we want to know about a person's hobbies or interests, we ask, what does he, she like doing? People like doing different activities. Some prefer things they can do at home, like watching TV, or reading a book, or playing board games, or even surfing the internet, cooking, or baking. These are all indoor activities. Other people prefer doing sports, like playing football, playing basketball, tennis, going swimming, going jogging, climbing, doing judo, or doing yoga. Good for them. Many people prefer more social activities like hanging out with friends, relaxing with family, going shopping, eating out, going to a party, or going to the theater or the cinema. A few people enjoy doing creative activities like taking photos, drawing, writing a blog or stories or a vlog, painting, dancing, or playing an instrument. When they are on holiday, a lot of people love doing outdoor activities like going camping, or hiking, or horse riding, or cycling. Well, those who are really brave can try rafting, and hang gliding, or skydiving, and even scuba diving. Which would you like to try? We are going to take a look at these 8 pictures representing hobbies and free time activities, and there will be 8 people whose description we will have on the screen. You have to decide which activity is suitable for them. Let's see the first one. Mary would like a fun night at home with her best friend.
I think it's picture 7.
Yes, it's playing board games. That's a good way to spend time with your friend.
John likes adventure and he's not afraid of heights.
Well, he must be really brave. He should go hang gliding. Tina would like a calm holiday in the mountains with little money to spend, which means that going camping is the best activity for her.
Mark is interested in playing a team sport inside. He's rather tall and fit.
He should play
basketball.
Yes.
Very good. Anne wants to take up some classes in her free time. She's a calm and peaceful person.
I think she should do yoga because this is what really relaxes your mind.
Peter loves being in the water. He is a good swimmer and wants to try something new.
He should try scuba diving.
Anne loves music and rhythm. She's like an activity for the evenings.
Dancing is the best thing for her.
Sam has had a few difficult days and needs some time in the company of people he is comfortable with.
Well, this means spending time with friends. Hanging out with your friends. They are always giving you a good mood. What do you like doing in your free time? Here are some sentences, some examples of what people like doing and how we express them.
I like playing basketball. I always play at the weekend.
I love going swimming. It keeps me fit.
I enjoy playing board games with my friends. We have a lot of fun.
I prefer reading to watching TV. Books help you be imaginative.
I fancy playing the guitar. My best friend helps me learn.
I'm interested in reading short stories. They're captivating.
I'm really into doing yoga. It relaxes me.
As you can see, the verbs that we use to show what we like are like, love, enjoy, prefer, fancy, or expressions like be interested in, be into something. Now, what are your least favorite activities?
I don't like playing computer games. I find them boring.
I hate doing the dishes. I only do it when I have to.
Keen on cooking. I prefer eating out.
I'm quite bad at drawing. I think I should quit.
I can't stand going to the disco. It's too loud.
I'm not good at dancing. I'm really clumsy.
I'm not a fan of hiking. I enjoy short walks.
The verbs that we use to express what we don't like are don't like, hate, not be keen on something, be bad or quite bad at, can't stand doing, or not be good or not be a fan of something. What follows next is another video. We are going to listen to the video and watch the people speaking there, and I want you to take a pencil and a piece of paper and write down the numbers from 1 to 10. There are some words missing, which you can find here, but they're not arranged in the right order. So you have to write them in the right order. Let's watch the video.
What do you like doing?
I like riding a bike. I love driving. And I like cooking.
I like traveling and I really love taking photos.
I like running, I like football, I like going out with my friends, I like going to restaurants.
I like listening to music, and I like going to the cinema.
Oh, I like cooking a lot, and also I like reading, I like gardening, and I like going to the cinema.
What don't you like doing?
I don't like waiting, and I hate taking the bus.
I really don't like watching TV, and I hate playing video games. I find them boring.
I don't like getting up early. I don't like working.
I don't like playing video games.
I hate doing sports, and I really don't like going on Facebook.
Ready? Now check your answers. Let's see. Love. Traveling. Really. Cooking. Going. Don't like. Playing. Video games. Doing. Going. So your text might should sound like, I like riding the bike and love driving. I like traveling and I
really love taking photos. And so on and so forth. You have done it right. Now, let's see. Remember, for verbs of likes and dislikes, we use subject, then the verb, and the verb in ing. Let's practice together. Dana, what do you like doing in your free time?
In my free time, I like hiking, but I love just relaxing, reading a book, and watching a very good film. What do you like doing at the weekend?
Well, at the weekend, I enjoy going out, and I hate doing housework, although I have to. What about when you go on holiday? What do you fancy?
Well, when I go on holiday, I fancy visiting new places, meeting new people, and doing something new. Nicoletta, what are you really good at?
I'm really good at cooking, but I'm quite bad at swimming. I've never really liked it. Now, is there something you can't stand?
Well, I usually love things. I can't stand when people lie to me, but let's see. I can't stand doing nothing. I'm very active.
You're right. Okay, now we'd like to give our thanks to those who inspired us in doing this video and the whole World Wide Web for giving us access to the pictures we have used. Thank you. Next time we will talk about
present tense simple versus present tense continuous.
This is it for today. Thank you for being with us. Goodbye.
See you soon. Bye.
Mi-ai salvat viața. Eu voi face totul pentru a o salva pe a ta și pe a celor dragi nouă. Oricât de greu ne-a fost sau ne va mai fi, nu vom irosi efortul tuturor. Grija pe care ne-o purtăm va învinge virusul. Respectăm regulile, știind că doar noi facem să conteze viețile salvate. Doar noi aducem normalitatea mai aproape. În fiecare zi, ca o echipă. O echipă pentru viață. Campanie de informare susținută de Guvernul României.
Bună ziua, numele meu este Isaia Dida Cristina și sunt profesor de matematică. Pentru astăzi v-am pregătit la clasa 6-a o lecție operații cu mulțimi. Să scriem titlul, operații cu mulțimi. a apărut și curcubeul, din care două fete, prietene, și-au ales culorile preferate. Ana a notat mulțimea cu amare și a scris culorile roșu, galben, albastru, indigo. Bianca a notat mulțimea cu B mare și a scris oranj, galben, verde, indigo și violet. Putem alcătui o mulțime care să conțină culorile preferate de Ana sau de Bianca. Această mulțime poartă denumirea de reuniune și conține un simbol special sub forma literei U mare. Deci prima operație cu mulțime de astăzi este reuniunea. Observăm aici în cele două diagrame, am scris culorile preferate de cele două prietene și a reunit cu vecite, este formată din elementele roșu, albastru, galben, indigo, oranj, verde, violet. Să dăm și definiția. Reuniunea a două mulțimi A mare și B mare este mulțimea formată din elementele care aparțin cel puțin uneia dintre mulțimile A mare sau B mare. Scriem A reunit cu B este formată din acele elemente X cu proprietatea că X aparține lui A sau X aparține lui B. Putem alcătui o mulțime care să conțină culorile preferate de Ana și Bianca. Această mulțime poartă denumirea de intersecție și conține un simbol special, ca un U mare, dar întors. Intersecția este cea de-a doua operație cu mulțimi. După cum putem observa în cele două diagrame, culorile pe care le preferă ambele fete sunt galben și indigo. Deci A intersectat cu B va fi formată din elementele galben-indigo. Să dăm și definiția. Intersecția a două mulțimi A mare și B mare este mulțimea formată din elementele comune mulțimilor A și B. Scriem A intersectat cu B este formată din acele elemente X cu proprietatea că X aparține lui A și X aparține lui B. Avem și o a treia definiție aici, și anume faptul că două mulțimi a căror intersecție este mulțimea vidă se numesc mulțimi disjuncte. Să reținem acest nou cuvânt disjuncte pentru că îl vom întâlni și la geometrie. Putem alcătui o mulțime care să conțină culorile preferate doar de Ana, nu, și de Bianca. Această mulțime poartă denumirea de diferență și conține simbolul matematic pentru operația de scădere sau acest simbol sub forma unei liniuțe oblice. Această nouă operație poartă denumirea de diferență. După cum observăm în aceste două diagrame, A minus B va fi alcătuită din roșu și albastru. Definiția 4. Diferența a două mulțimi A și B este mulțimea formată din elementele lui A care nu aparțin lui B. Scriem A minus B este formată din acele elemente X cu proprietatea că X aparține lui A și X nu aparține lui B. Avem observația aici. Și anume că, în general, A minus B este diferit de B minus A. Exerciții rezolvate. 1. Să se identifice egalitățile adevărate. Punctul A. Mulțimea vidă reunită cu mulțimea formată din 1, 2 și 3 este egală cu mulțimea formată din 1, 2 și 3. Punctul B. Mulțimea formată din 5, 6, 7 și 8 intersectată cu mulțimea formată din 1 și 10 este egală cu mulțimea vidă. Punctul C. Mulțimea formată din 0 și 1 minus mulțimea formată din 1, 2, 3 și 4 este egală cu mulțimea formată din 0. Punctul D. Mulțimea formată din 11 reunită cu mulțimea formată din 12 reunită cu mulțimea formată din 13 este egală cu mulțimea formată din elementele 1, 2 și 3. Revenim acum la punctul A. Avem reuniune, da? și știm că într-o reuniune elementele trebuie să aparțină primei mulțimi sau celei de-a doua mulțimi. Și în cazul nostru este adevărată această egalitate, deoarece mulțimea avidă nu are niciun element, reunită cu mulțimea formată din 1, 2 și 3, vom obține într-adevăr mulțimea formată din 1, 2 și 3. Punem adevărat. La punctul B avem intersecție, va trebui să scriem acele elemente care aparțin primei mulțimi și celei de-a doua mulțimi. Observăm că cele două mulțimi nu au elemente comune. Într-adevăr, intersecția lor este mulțimea vidă, adică cele două mulțimi sunt disjuncte. La punctul C, diferență, va trebui să căutăm acele elemente care sunt în prima mulțime și nu sunt în cea de-a doua. Și observăm că 0 este elementul care este în prima mulțime și nu se regăsește în cea de-a doua. Deci propoziția este adevărată. Iar aici, reuniunea celor trei mulțimi ar fi trebuit să ne dea 11, 12, 13. Da? Deci mulțimea formată din 11, 12, 13, dar noi avem aici mulțimea formată din 1, 2 și 3. Înseamnă că propoziția este falsă. Trecem la exercițiul numărul 2. Fie mulțimile A formată din acele elemente X cu proprietatea că X aparține lui N și X e mai mic de 4, și mulțimea B formată în acele elemente Y cu proprietatea că Y este de forma 2X plus 1, unde X este din A. Să se calculeze A reunit cu B, A intersectat cu B, A minus B și B minus A. Rezolvare. Elementele mulțimii A sunt toate numerele naturale strict mai mici decât 4, adică mulțimea va fi formată din 0, 1, 2 și 3. Vom determina acum elementele mulțimii B și vom lua x din A. Pentru x egal cu 0, vom face înlocuirea în expresia lui y și vom obține y egal cu 2 ori 0 plus 1, adică y este egal cu 1. La fel, vom înlocui x cu 1 și obținem y egal cu 3. Pentru x egal cu 2 vom obține y egal cu 5 și apoi facem înlocuirea cu ultimul element al lui A, și anume cu 3. Pentru x egal cu 3 vom obține y egal cu 7. Așadar, mulțimea B este formată din elementele 1, 3, 5 și 7. Rescriem elementele lui A, 0, 1, 2 și 3. Rescriem și elementele mulțimii B, 1, 3, 5 și 7. Reuniunea conține acele elemente care sunt în A sau în B. Începem să scriem elementele lui A și continuăm cu elementele lui B pe care nu le-am scris deja. Intersecția conține acele elemente comune lui A și lui B și observăm că sunt 1 și 3. A minus B înseamnă că vom scrie elementele care sunt în A și nu sunt în B, și anume 0 și 2. Și pentru B minus A vom scrie elementele care sunt în B și nu sunt în A. Și observăm că acestea sunt 5 și 7. Exercițiul numărul 3. Dacă mulțimea A este formată din A, literele A, B, C, D, mulțimea B e formată din literele B, C, E și mulțimea C este formată din literele A, C, F, să se determine A reunit cu B reunit cu C, A intersectat cu B intersectat cu C, paranteză A reunit cu B, închid paranteza, intersectat cu C, A reunit cu paranteză B minus C. Vom face diagramele celor trei mulțimi pentru a ne veni mai ușor să observăm ce avem de făcut în acest exercițiu. Mulțimea A, pentru mulțimea B, diagrama, și pentru mulțimea C facem diagrama. Și să scriem rezolvarea. Observăm că elementele care se găsesc în A sau în B sau în C sunt literele A, B, C, D, E și F. Elementul comun celor trei mulțimi este litera C. Pentru a rezolva cel de-al treilea subpunct, mai întâi vom scrie cât este reuniunea mulțimilor A și B, adică A, B, C, D, E, și vom intersecta cu mulțimea C, care e formată din elementele A, C și F. Și observăm că elementele comune sunt A și C. Pentru punctul 4 vom rezolva mai întâi B minus C și observăm că elementele care sunt în B și nu sunt în C sunt B și E și reunim cu elementele lui A și obținem A, B, C, D, E. Să facem și rezumatul zilei de astăzi. Astăzi am vorbit despre cele trei operații cu mulțimi, reuniunea, al cărei semn este sub formă de mare, intersecția este cea de-a doua operație cu mulțimi, a cărui simbol este un întors, și cea de-a treia operație cu mulțimi este diferența. Și am mai vorbit astăzi și despre mulțimi disjuncte. Cam atât a fost pentru astăzi. Vă mulțumesc pentru atenție. La revedere!